Hey everyone, welcome back to the show. It's the North American Challenger Series, and we've got Game 2 between Wasabi Gaming and Curse Academy just about ready to go. Curse Academy, of course, do lead 1-0 after a very commanding Game 1.
Oh yeah, it was all that early game from St. Vicious on the Lee Sin, flipping over a new leaf from the last time we saw him play Lee Sin. Very aggressive still, but very calculated. He went 5-2 and 13 and dominated the early game in a late game scaling team comp.
Mm-hmm.
Which is exactly what he needed to do on that champion.
Yeah, he got his lane rolling, especially the mid lane rolling. Of course, in Mancloud, got to capitalize on those Lee Sin ganks. So he didn't get an assist on the first blood. He actually was out of range, just survived thanks to the Lee Sin. But still, 12-0 and 12, 85% kill participation. And he got a bunch of the kills just by himself, unassisted.
Yeah, a lot of those solo kills in the late game, ruining Saint's kill participation, who was really high in the early game, but that was exactly what he needed to do for Mancloud, who just grew up, and we talked about him being a huge, beautiful butterfly, and then he was like, now I'm going to just solo kill everybody on their team, end the game very quickly. Great performance there from Curse Academy.
Yeah.
And we talked about it before, where Baby Zeus loves to like leave casting up and try fighting that champion. It didn't work out. St. Vicious had done his homework and said, you're going to camp this lane, Ziplock. I'm going to be there first. Turns around the gank for the first blood on himself and then continues to capitalize off of that with Vision, keeping tabs around the mid lane where Ziplock was going to be.
Yeah, and it was beautiful play. I got to say, you know, down the line, great stuff at Curse Academy. They don't make the same mistake. They're going to ban Kasten in a way to get that one away from Baby Zeus. Aurelius still banned away from Kenny. The Rengar, the Yasuo, the Braum, they add that one against Funny Foo Foo, makes plenty of sense here, and the Zig still goes away, so Curse Academy only get to leave up the Lucian that they banned last
There's
time.
Still a lot of different bans here from Wasabi Gaming, though. Gragas, Lulu still on the field, top laners that are highly contested right now. We're probably going to see both of them this game.
There's a really good chance of that one. There we go. Lulu the hover on Gragas. Tristan actually still comes through for impactful, so Latman gets Lucian whenever he wants. And actually, pretty much, these guys could pick almost the same team comp on Wasabi Game if they wanted to. For the rest of it, I suppose. I don't know why I said that. But basically, like, the rest of what they went for is unbanned, so... and plus, like, they basically get the Lucian they wanted if they want it. Ziplock can still go for his Elise. Like, 10Q can still go for the Morgana. That's what I was trying to say.
Hey, they first second picked those champions.
Right, exactly. That was their first round last
time. Just 2-3 them now after they got the high priority Lulu. Makes sense, and then wait for some counter picks. You'll at least see what the support is, or they mean if they support and jungle on their next picks. Then you're just like, okay, we really just wanted these high priority champions taken away from you. It's really what Wasabi's doing.
Yeah, at this point, I expect Curse Academy to wait on their mid lane pick. There doesn't seem to be a real need to rush it. But you know, I've been wrong before in this one because hey, look, they just hovered on Orianna. The Lee Sin though has been great for Saint. I would lock them. They're going to blind pick Ori. That's interesting.
Hey, when the Assassin meta went out of style, Mancloud started picking up the Orianna a whole bunch. He's one of the champions he had great showings on in the LCS. Now we're going to see him on it again, and they take that away from Baby Zeus.
Yeah.
So that he has to play something else.
Well, we'll see. Baby Zeus has been known to play some Lulu, even though she's been more frequently a top laner in the past. But we'll see what kind of matchups they go for here. Kenny, of course, a big carry type player. That's going to spam the random button for a while until they figure out what he actually wants to play in this one. But they needed the AD carry here. I still expect that to be Lucian because it was left up and it was banned worthy last time. We don't typically see a lot of AD carry bans unless they're basically Tristana.
Sometimes or like Cog.
Yeah, occasionally Cog, right? Like those are the two that seem to only pull bans right now. And they were so afraid of it, they banned it in game one. Latman's going to get it this time around. Wasabi Gaming are going to go for the top lane Munda.
Yep, and it's going to be the mid lane Lulu here, which isn't that surprising because Orianna, Kassadin, Ziggs, Yasuo have been taken off the field by bans or picks, and that really just leaves Baby Zeus with champions way further down in his pool. His top four champions have all been taken out right now,
right.
And all the other ones have been nerfed, like Nidalee, or taken out, and you can't really play it. Karthus isn't that great, and he usually plays into Yasuo.
Yep.
They hovered over the Fizz for a bit, but then they're like, nah, we're not going to play Fizz into Orianna. We're going to go ahead and try to just swap it up.
Yeah.
There's a lot of early game pressure here from Wasabi in the mid lane. Their jungle, their AD carry. Top lane, a little bit of a scaling Mundo there. Curse Academy, a lot of AoE, a lot of scaling here for them. Gragas, you also have Orianna, great teamfight prowess between those two champions. Tristana, just the constant threat. I like this team comp so far from Curse Academy, and also the pickup on Lee Sin again for Saint.
Yeah. So here we go, Curse Academy, just a pretty strong generalist type composition. Team fighting is good with Shockwave and a Tristana. Thresh, of course, can make plenty of plays, as can Lee Sin. So Curse Academy, honestly, a bunch of playmakers, and I want to see how that pans out for them. Wazaga Gaming is more of a slow burn type composition. Yeah. It's like, it's kind of interesting when you compare a champion like Lucian to a Tristana or a Cog, because Tristana and Kog'Maw, despite just being good, sort of all-around good late-game AD carries, they actually have windows of power. Like, Rapid Fire lasts for 7 seconds with a 20-second cooldown, so it's up a third of the time. Kog'Maw, I believe it's 8 and 17, or 6 and 17. I know it's a 17-second cooldown. I want to say it's like 8 seconds on. And so he's unpowered for about half the time, and he has to kind of wait around for a while. Lucian is kind of always powerful, cycling spells around. And again, you've got a Mundo in here, a Lulu in here, guys that are going to live in fights for a while and go for multiple sort of sets of spells. And if Wasabi Gaming can actually withstand the front-end burst of things, which Mundo often does, they just keep throwing out damage and they can wear down a team fight.
Yeah, the persistent team fight and getting more rotations of your spells off is going to be the key here for them from Wasabi Gaming. But yeah. Curse Academy, on the other side, like you said, they have a very generalist composition. I'd call it a little more versatile.
That
can be the word that I would use.
Okay.
Because they can split push. They can try and dominate a little bit of the early game with Lee Sin. Mm-hmm. They can scale into late game with Orianna. They can wave clear very well if they're behind. It's kind of like we don't have just one or two cards. We can play on the fly very well with what we've chosen.
Yeah. And they can also just play Protect the Tristana at the end of it all.
Yes.
You've got a lot of ways to support them. You got Thresh. You got Orianna. Both are very good at keeping AD carries alive. And in fact, there's not even a lot of threats for him anyway. Tristana is one of those champions that I'm like comfortable fighting Mundo with because I know he can't guarantee that I'll die. I can, you know, and Explosive Shots is so good against it, et cetera, et cetera. There's so many good reasons to play Trist into Mundo. So I'm actually a little bit worried for Wasabi Gaming then, kind of at the end of Champs, like, because I do think Curse Academy's lineup actually looks very strong. There's a lot of ways they can go with it, which you talked about. And Curse Academy look really good right now.
Yeah, they look really good. And also, they can pick people with Thresh. There's a whole bunch of stuff they can do. You're going to be starting to identify their win conditions pretty much mid-game because they most likely know what they're going to try to do.
Yeah.
And then once the lanes start going, whichever which way they go, if there's a lane swap, whatever the strategy is coming into it, you can adapt on the fly very quickly. And if you're Wasabi Gaming, you're looking at a comp like this and you're like, all right, what do we have to do? Because it's not very clear. It's not like Protect the Kog'Maw, shut down the Kog'Maw before he gets going.
Right.
It's not a cast and shut him down first. Can't mid do this or that. It's kind of, all right, let's think about who we fear the most and how do we keep them down, or do we just crush lanes? They got some early game for themselves. What do they do with it?
Well, that's a difficult thing here for Wasabi Gaming, actually. You talk about, you know, what can the teams do with their compositions. There's not a lot of ways for Wasabi Gaming to go, right? You again talked about there's so many ways for Curse Academy to play it, and again, I'm just going to go back and say I agree with you, but I do want to talk about Wasabi, because not only is their team fight this, like, tanky slow burn, where it will eventually work for them, but also, like, what's your playmaking? Like, you can Whimsy into a Dark Binding, like, maybe you get, like, the Binding Cocoon combo, and that's not bad, but your targets are Mundo, right? Like, Lee Sin, who can ward hop away. Orianna's the only non-mobile champion on that roster, and you've got a Thresh here to keep her alive. Like, you bind her, she shockwaves your team to disengage, grabs a lantern, and you peace out.
Yeah,
like, I feel like there's very few ways for Wasabi Gaming to make plays, to force the issue, to make things happen. It's like, they have to be at Dragon, somehow make you stop harassing them, and then take the Dragon and go back to the lanes.
It's going to be very difficult, because it's kind of a chase-you-down, Glitter Lance, burn you with Mundo composition,
right.
Whereas there's a lot of answers here between Orianna with the Dissonance, Shockwave, Gragas can disengage a fight completely, Thresh can save somebody. There's a lot here for Curse Academy, but you know, all of these different things aren't really huge factors if somebody just crushes lane off of a misplay very quickly, and it's like, oh god, this Lucian is three-shotting people, they grouped up 27 minutes in, they're knocking at our Nexus turrets.
Yeah.
Whole lot can go in Wasabi's favor.
That's true.
But it's just how the game plan pans out and what people do inside of it.
Exactly, yeah. This hand was like, I'm ready to talk. I didn't have to like cut you off. But
no, I gotcha.
Yeah, it's basically, I agree with you. Like, the laning phase could be so good for Wasabi Gaming because they did well the first time around. I know 10Q is incredibly good from what I saw from the first game. He can set up Latman so well. And what can happen here, basically, is they can win the bot lane so hard, and he's been good with Black Shields. He's been blocking Braum Qs. He could probably block Thresh Hooks as well. Crush that lane so hard, win it, and then be like, as you talked about, Lucian three-shotting people, that can just win you a game outright.
And it looks like they're going for a lane swap into the top lane here. Actually, no, they're just going for an invade. They tried this last time, too. They're going to go invade. Kenny shows himself to Chris. But that's not unorthodox to see the top laner there. But he actually saw more.
Binding?
The binding.
Ooh! That was real close.
Looked like he was following his bottom as he body slammed out. He's like sitting on it all the way, propelled him.
Yeah. You know, you run faster when things are chasing you. How that works. I mean, if I had a dark binding behind me, I would run fast.
You book it faster, yeah. Try to get out of there.
I would try really hard to not get dark binded. I don't have 180 health. Ooh. I would get one shot by that thing.
Looking for an aggressive play at the start of this game by Wasabi. Ooh, lines up.
Big damage comes through Kenny at half HP, but gets the cleaver onto Saint Vicious. Hook's going to miss as well. Saint, of course, does not have ward hop. He might have to flash this one. 100 health, gets the shield coming out. Glitterlance lands. Bunny tanks the cleaver, and they're going to be able to stay away safely. Chris spots that out. He's going to peace out, too.
Nobody blows any summoner spells. Saint's like, nope, GG. Not going to blow it. Not going to panic. Great presence of mind there to know the damage output. And he also got the shield from Mancloud, which actually doesn't put Mancloud too far behind in lane, because that's what you do as a level 1 Orianna most of the time when you're harassing.
Yeah, a lot of the matchups are fine to go shield first and just go for the auto attack trade.
Yeah.
So
it's not like going E first on Elise, being like,
oh,
I can't do this
or
camp.
Or Lucian.
Yeah, oh god.
Yeah, look, it's a bit better now, I guess, E first on Lucian.
Yeah, but I mean, in this patch right now, you currently can't clear a wave and get level 2 first. No. You would totally get pushed in by the Tristana. And she hit level 2 and try to all in you off a hook.
In fact, this is a whole team of champions you don't want to start E at level 1 for Wasabi Gaming. Curse Academy can do it on all of them. All of them are happy to start with E.
Yeah.
There you go. Information granted.
A lot of them actually want to start with E.
Yep. But we're going to look at the players get more levels before they really fight. So now Mancloud has Q as well. I feel like he would never go Dissonance Protect, but hey. Doesn't matter. He didn't get it.
I don't want to move the ball around. I just want to walk on things.
I just want to walk on things. Melee Orianna, new strat. Don't run Q. Please don't do that. Unless you're against me. Then go ahead.
Ah, Freak told me to do it.
Oh my gosh.
Going into solo Q.
Also, jungle Lulu. Well, level 3 comes out for Captain Ziploc. Got his blue buff, so his mana is going to come back in. Baby Zeus puts the ward on the top side, which does actually correctly track where Saint Vicious is right now.
Ziploc looking for a gank up top. He's going to avoid this river ward. Get his way into this lane.
Well, the thing is, Chris hasn't been playing very aggressively, so I feel like all Ziploc can do is predict counter ganks here and then be like, oh, no, nothing happened here. I don't think there's an easy way to get in and get a kill there.
It's pretty crazy, though, because it's a Gragas. Gragas is typically will be right up in your face at the start of the game.
But it's been Kenny who's been pushing. And to be honest, I think this is fine because Gragas can last hit under turret very well. He's got all of his cooldowns can be used to last hit
no ward.
Easily. Okay, well, there's the flash play. Gets onto two of them. Ignite out of Latman. Who's going to get the black shield?
Hook ready.
They're trying to run away. And no, they catch 10Q right off the bat. He's got almost nowhere to go. Flash and heal are burned there. They're still putting damage on Impactful. Using a lot of health for this one. They're still chasing 10Q. Play well by Lamp with the bind onto St. Vicious. But he's going to ward hop. Not even ward hop. Just hop to a thrash and get away for this one. No one is around turning around, but Latman still wants his battle. Wow, forces the flash with the aggression. Bunny going to play Latman back. He still has his flash. He's going to fight this 1v3. Latman. He could have flashed out of that, but he's gonna.
Whoop.
God.
Latman versus the world.
That was impressive, though. Latman did not show fear that entire time.
He got a couple flashes too.
Mm-hmm.
And now, see Ziploc wrapping around.
Well, he knows there's no one in the jungle anymore. Saint's got too little health to do anything, so someone stays.
He could dive this.
Yes, he can.
And then rappel up. They're gonna see him though.
There's not enough minions to make this dive happen. I don't think he's gonna get spotted right now on that ward.
Yeah, that ward's a really good, really good ward. Really well placed. Ziploc standing on top of it, they see it coming. Saint's booking it down there. And they're trying to keep the wave off for as long as possible.
Yeah, Trish is pushing his fat. Oh, here's Morg, though. They can do this. Here they go.
Cocoon.
Damage. He's got a repel, it. Like right. Ooh, perfect repel. Thank you. Pulls aggro, though, in towards Impactful. It's okay if he dies. It's going to be the kill. The rocket jump. He can kill Ziploc. He goes in.
Oh
my gosh, that was close. Ziploc with a midair auto attack.
That was like 10 HP. Literally 10. That was ridiculous. Oh, so
I got that game right back in for Wasabi.
They got the 2 kills onto Ziploc at the start of the game on the bottom lane, not putting the same attention middle. We're going to take another look at that. Cocoon, right as the hook comes out, he's able to repel. Oh, he actually got killed before the hook landed, so he didn't even throw it out. This was huge. He gets a shot in the back, and bam.
Wow. The rocket jump landed, just couldn't get the auto attack down quite. So Wasabi Gaming looking at it better now. 400 gold up on Kenny Yu, up 7 CS in his lanes. That's the same as before. The mid laners treading water, 42-42, the exact same as last time. And right here, Latman up 15 CS over the Tristana. Once again, we've got the same situation going on here where, guess what, guys? Bottom lane's winning a little bit. Top lane's winning a little bit. Mid lane's holding equal. What next?
Latman got Lucian, though. Very high-priority champion for him that was banned away last time. And you can see right there, he's about twice the CS of the Tristana coming into this. They both have pickaxes, though. So he doesn't have any type of actual tangible advantage in his inventory. He's just got gold sitting in his inventory waiting. He's got some levels. Look at that.
Yeah.
They're very close. They're actually only 60.
Right. Well, that's the thing,
up.
Right? The Tristana got killed, right? Got an assist on there as well. So she has the first blood gold, and that's why you see that kind of situation. The real big advantage is simply the fact that Elise, right here, there's a score line, up 400 gold over
right,
the opposition.
There
it is. Yeah.
Right
my hand disappears underneath it. but she's actually got an item lead here, right? She's the one who's got finished sight stone, or not finished sight, sorry, finished spirit stone, amplifying tome, boots of speed as well. Saint's got like a long sword and like a machete and like maybe boots and stuff as well. But like you have an actual, it's actually just that, right? Like that is a significant item lead across the junglers here, which you can pay forward. It's a difficult thing. It's a gold lead that you have to try really hard to manipulate. If you're like fighting in the bottom lane and you're like up a BF sword, like great, if we trade, you die, right? And you can push your weight around and that's easy. If you're Elise and Lee Sin and they're just clearing the jungle over and over again, you don't really get any advantage from your item lead. So it's going to be, I think, still up to Captain Ziplock to make good plays.
Yeah, as a jungler, I like to think of it like this, where when you get the gold on a laner, it's constantly present gold in combat stats in a matchup. When you're in the jungle, it's very temporary combat stats that run into a lane, and it's like, did I tilt the lane? All right, let's come back. So it's like a kind of burst of power that shows itself every now and then. Granted, it can move itself around the map, but it's not always in a matchup, constantly fighting against somebody else's gold.
Yeah, and so it's up to Captain Ziplock to, show up to the lanes in time, show up at the right positions and
get to push
it happen. Yeah, and the thing is, there's only so many lanes with kill pressure, because Mundo doesn't have the best kill pressure on Gragas. At this point, Gragas has his ultimate. Right about now, by 6 minutes, you typically have it. So good luck making that dive happen without more items coming through yet, right? You've got tanks coming in there. Mid lane, Lulu versus Orianna. Again, really low kill pressure there. Hard to make that happen. Even if you land the cocoon, I don't know if you really even kill Mancloud in that case. So it's like only the bot lane can you really force this issue. And then you can. Cocoon binding, you just kind of chase through. Maybe you have enough there. But that's like the only one you can very obviously tilt.
Yeah, not a lot of gank assistance and kill pressure in these lanes. So it's very hard to get a grasp on them. That bottom lane, though, we almost saw that gank completely turned around by Latman, who's like, all right, I'll actually get three people low. And then they took complete advantage of that, and Ziplock being right in time for that.
And Saint Vicious identifying how important this bottom lane is, and he's already on the way down here. Health bars are full for Wasabi. Three of the four summoners up for the Wasabi Gaming bottom lane. Impactful has all of his, and there's the push on in. Ooh, dashed away from the Q hook. Actually misses 10 key right here. Nothing gained.
Ziplock just clearing his jungle, saying they can all just fend for themselves. Even in the bottom lane, but there's a little bit of a bigger wave in Curse Academy's favor. So Latman has actually more CS to pick up for himself if he can last hit on the turret.
Should be pretty doable. Looks like he's going to stay safe on this one. And so here's the real test then. I feel like waiting for late game is not the easy play here for Wasabi. Just because I feel like it's going to be hard to get to that stage of the game, because Curse Academy has so much playmaking potential there. Ooh, wow. Kenny actually forced the ulti out of Chris, but he juked backwards just in time to dodge that one. And so here's the battle. Yeah, he's actually a level up right here. That's actually one of the advantages that doesn't show with the gold lead, but Latman was part of so many kills and so many more minion deaths that he has a level lead on Trist. And you can see him forcing Impactful back, and really, that's actually pretty relevant right now.
Yeah, pushing those extra stats that you got from the level and the extra ability and damage is really big in a lane, especially when your support's both backed up to one-on-one.
Fancy moves, goes back and forth. Okay, 600 gold lead is what happened basically after those kills went through. That's the actual number I want to track then to see who's playing better from that point on. 7.5 minutes in, still the harass coming through. 10Q getting the gold off of his Frostfang, whatever. So far, no one's made any big moves to control Dragon or to force any other ganks. We haven't seen stuff from Captain Ziplock just yet here. But now with this wave onto the turret.
Missed the cannon.
Yeah, this is always the test. It's like when you have a cannon wave pushing in, both junglers say, hey, this lane could have a dive right now. Do I gank? Do I counter gank? Do I dive? Which of the three are we doing? And both junglers are going to decide, you know what? I'll back off.
How about I farm?
Yeah.
Seems to be the way to go here. Kenny with his ultimate, Chris with no mana.
He still hasn't backed it off the first set of items. And actually, this might be enough money, enough damage to kill Chris. He will have to flash. He flashes early. Kenny,
misses
the cleaver. He did not wait for body slam. And that was the dodge that Chris needed to get away. He stays safe on this one. Seems like actually doesn't finish killing the pink ward. He wants to stop this back.
He had just enough mana for the body slam. He's getting collapsed on right now.
Here they go.
Oh, the setup.
Kenny, he pulled aggro first. He goes down. He didn't need to. Captain Ziplock actually is going to get away for this one. They trade kills. But now he's on the wrong side of the map. Saint not going to chase him just yet.
Ooh.
We saw him go back over.
It's that sight stone paying off. Ziplock actually can beat him in a one-on-one.
He's got
unless he lands the Q.
Same combat. That's the problem. He's dead. He's gone.
Yep.
So that's the problem with going Spirit Stone, though.
Yeah.
Is there's no combat stat. Like, they literally have the same value of stats here. Actually, Satan has more because he has the health from the Ruby Crystal for the Sight Stone. Latman just stays from the turret, kills that one off. Bunny Foo puts the Lantern in for Bunny Foo Foo. The ulti comes in for 10Q,
GP.
Though, and backs him off. It will complete for Chris. Oh. Jumping in, doesn't land the slow. Explosive cask is up. He knocks him back. Beautiful shot right here.
He's got flash.
Q slow. Good flash. Gets away. 10Q dodges the hook as well. Perfectly played by Morg. And that is a turret here for Wasabi.
They might actually go for the dragon now. We'll have to see. Saint just got out of the base and he's trying to run up. And yeah, the fact that he landed the Q and didn't hit one of the spiderlings with it was actually really huge in that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a big part of Elise versus Lee Sin is, do you hit the spiderling with a Q? If you do, you're usually going to lose.
Yeah. Life becomes pain if that kind of happens. Ikenyu wants to teleport in to stop the dragon, and it is enough to force them back. Ziplock gets the stun on a Chris. Here comes Baby Zeus. Lantern comes out, getting him a little bit more to safety, and they will stay alive. Blue buff is up, and Chris Academy turn their attention there. That means dragon could go to Wasabi.
That's going to be a big gold burst for them, because they also just got themselves a turret.
Wow, so look at that. Wasabi Gaming actually up 2,000 gold. We did talk about the bottom turret going down. In fact, minion waves crashed against the top lane outer turret before Kenny teleported in. He had actually shoved the wave, got all the pressure he needed for Chris leaving the lane, denied gold, denied XP, shows up very cleanly. The bottom lane, we saw the turret going down. When the team grouped back up for Dragon, they had shoved the entire wave into the bottom tier 2. All that gold, all that experience going to waste. Wasabi making the right call. So suddenly this game, a complete 180 from game one. Suddenly, they're the guys going aggressive but making largely the correct choices. They're making the right map-wide movements, which is huge. The fact that Kenny is showing up at the right times now. Chris teleports, doesn't get anything for it. Kenny teleports, does. That's huge.
Yeah, that's really big in terms of economy of summoner spells.
Mm-hmm.
And another thing here, too, just talking about economy, 71 to 34 in AD carry CS, now a tangible BF sword in the inventory of Latman. That's going to be huge in these upcoming fights. It's one of the reasons why they couldn't actually fight that dragon because of that lead. We saw it too last time. Latman got a BF sword before his opponent, before Impactful had one, and then won a dragon fight off of it. And Curse Academy's like, we've seen this before. We're going to back off and then just try to come back later.
Yeah. And I mean, if you go by the sort of history repeating itself, Curse Academy generally tend to make better map-wide shot calls. If that is in your mind, you can say, okay, we'll give up some objectives. That was kind of the old counter-logic gaming way of playing the game. Say, look, we can give up dragons occasionally. It's only 1,000 gold. We'll come back later. We'll outplay them somewhere else. You can only do that so many times. 6,000 gold is a pretty large deficit to come back from. Right now, it's only a couple. It's, okay, 2K. That's not gigantic, but it does matter. But I have to question how long Curse Academy waits on this. Because they have this really, really upsetting 34 CS at 10 for their AD carry. That is a ludicrously low score. Like, mid-70s is what you expect, and surprise is what we see here from the AD carry of Wasabi Gaming. But the problem is, where does your win come from if you're losing in globals and your late-game carry isn't even getting money?
Yeah, there's actually a lot of discrepancy here between everybody on the map.
Yeah.
Top lane, it's a 500 gold difference currently. Mid lane, no, it's pretty even there. That's where they're holding parity.
Right. But
then it's those AD carries. It's almost 800, almost 1,000 BF sword up in completion.
Yeah.
Just really, really big here. Because if you actually look at it, Tristana, he's sitting on 400 gold.
Mm-hmm.
that means he's not going to have that BF sword for a very long time.
1,000 gold away. Mm-hmm. That's really rough. And that takes like 8 minutes to farm up. And that's if you get good CS the whole way through. And of course, keep in mind when you look at those gold leads, about 300 of that roughly is the global gold that's been acquired by Wasabi Gaming. And, you know, when you see a matchup tip by a little bit sometimes, hey, my Battleman got a turret. That's awesome. Hey, they took the dragon. That's awesome. That gives me an extra item ledge over my opposition. But yeah, down the line, over and over again, Wasabi Gaming are making the better choice. And as soon as they started to get into the correct team fights, they were a team to be feared again. That was all it took, and they found that, and that's the big thing for them. And you've got ways for Curse Academy to get back in, but they've got to find them. Hey, by the way, your front line is still scaling up. You've got damage Elise coming through. You don't have a ton of ability power yet on Lulu. Catches can still work. Good shockwaves can still turn the game. 25 minutes down the line, Tristana might come online, but that one isn't in the playbook right now. It's very much about, look, we need some good plays by Lee Sin before they get too big.
Yeah, and actually, fun fact here, I was doing some research on outside tournaments, and Wasabi Gaming has actually beaten Team 8, Coast, and Curse Academy, all three of them at least taking a game off of them or put up a great fight. So they actually have, you know, if they were putting little notches in their computer case, they could actually put notches on all three of those teams. So they've beaten top teams in Challenger.
Yeah.
And the question is, do they show up today? Do they continue pushing this lead and actually just make that notch just a gigantic gash and be like, Curse Academy's done.
Done. Just cut them out. Like, yeah. I don't have a good analogy for that. Also, maybe like each one is a stick of RAM with like their name on it. But like, why would you reduce RAM from your computer? So I don't
know. Replace it with the better one.
Oh, yeah. You got to replace it with a better RAM. It's now Wasabi Gaming RAM. It's ours now. You just like have one. I don't have a good analogy for computer cases and teams you beat up. Guys, tweet at LOL Esports. Let us know the best analogies, the best metaphors for beating up on people in the video games. So, of course, we are on a pause right here. We're going to get ourselves back in as soon as we can, of course. You're still on Battle, aren't you?
No, I was thinking about JD Wu.
Why? What's the deal?
Like, sometimes you're trash canning somebody, you're dumpstering them. They got landfilled.
Landfill is my favorite term for someone being bad, or are you beating up on somebody? It's a good term. I mean, you got double ifs, everyone else is trash. You got to one up that and be like, everyone else is a landfill. That is so much trash. Did you know, actually, if you call someone a trash can, that is a compliment because they're good enough to carry trash? Did you know?
Okay.
Information gained. Got you covered, guys. All right. Oh. No, I almost didn't have anything. It was like a period.
It was like
a telegraph right. Where you say stop instead of period. It's da 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 da. All right, and that's where I
would have been your Morse code stop.
Yeah.
All right.
No, it was stupid. I don't know. I don't think telegraph's even the right term for this one. Is it telegram?
I think it's telegram.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we figured it out in the end. There. The more you know. Telegram's not
might
even
be
relevant.
Might be telegraph. I don't know.
You know what? I've forgotten. It doesn't matter anymore.
I am not an expert on Morse code.
Nor am I.
All of the.
They're before
wow.
My time.
We have so much in common.
We're both in our mid 20s and we're older than some technologies now, or I guess younger in this case. Right. So I don't know what to say about this game. Unfortunately, we're only 10 minutes in. Right.
I don't want to talk about too much because you know.
Yeah.
At this point, people.
You know what? Let's go back to being analyst desk from LCS.
All right, all right.
Because we had so many things we were going to talk about during that. And of course, being that we have games to be played, like we had to stop talking about them so that like CLG could like play a match. And I mean, I guess if you really think Doublelift and Co. are more important than us, then I guess we'll play games instead of talking. But they've been gracious enough to pause for us so we can talk about things some more. So we were talking about innovation and new champions having an effect elsewhere on other people's champion pools, other people's play styles, right? You've got... Even though, like, it was just weird, like, Morgana, like, took this weird dip in popularity, and then came, like, she was, like, top tier, disappeared for a couple of seconds, and then came back when Braum was big again.
Same thing with Nami.
Right, yeah. Nami came up, I think, partially because of Morgana, as, like, she's a good counterpick in the matchup. And also, yeah, we talked to a lot of players saying that, well, late-game hyper carries are more important. And there's one thing, actually, that concerns me about this, is they're like, yeah, you can lose the laning phase now, because you have a late-game hyper carry. And, like, if that's your mindset... Where you can just like pick garbage matchups and just pick peel everywhere, you just lose a 20-minute game.
Yeah.
Like, they'll just take dragons on you, and you don't have the gold to come back in.
Yeah, we've seen a lot of teams attempt this, and I think it's one of the ways that Team 8 actually beat LMQ back when it was Challenger. It was like, we have Lucian. We have all of these early game team fighters. It's like, oh, we beat you in 27 minutes? What's up?
Yeah. And that's a pretty big concern. Because, hey, suddenly you pick these aggressive early game divers. Like, what if Rammus comes back? Now, I don't think Rammus is great against Trist, like, specifically, because I think she has the tools to, like, outplay that, or you bring the cleanse back on AD carries, which we saw, and those are really good ways to deal with that. But you've got a lot of interesting crossover because you have champions like Xerath who are coming out that are big now. And if he doesn't have any big escapes, champs like Vi and, of course, you love Jarvan get even more important because they have guaranteed ways of reaching that pool. And you can only Zhonya's or die.
Yeah, and it's kind of like when we saw Resurgence just in Fate, here comes Fizz again.
Yeah.
Xerath, it's like, okay, maybe Zed will become a thing. If you can dodge skill shots, who can start with Boots early?
Yeah, true.
You know, like today we saw Boy Boy playing the Tristana into a Xerath matchup and starting Boots 3 potions so that he could dodge everything.
And he didn't even die that game.
Yep. So,
impressive stuff for the man. We are back in, though. And Wasabi Gaming going to be nice and happy here as they sit on this 2,300 gold lead. Wards start coming out around the Baron area. Lantern comes out. Ooh, Saint Vicious has to flash the binding, though. Bunny Fufu trying to save him on this one. So 10Q is roaming out of his lane, warding other sides of the map. I want to know what the top lane or the top river wards are going to be for as time progresses here, but I guess we'll see in the future.
I don't think we are going to see, though, because excessive pause time has been called.
Oh, that's going to be
Curse
unfortunate.
Academy.
Yeah, so unfortunately, guys, Curse Academy is going to have to forfeit this game due to excessive pause time. So now the teams are going to be tied one game apiece. We'll be taking a quick break, but when we return, it's the decisive game 3 between Curse Academy and Wasabi Gaming. Don't go anywhere.